Hello guys, in the previous video we have seen about the probability of finding an electron in an atom. We came up with this term probability because according to Heisenberg uncertainty principle, we cannot exactly locate the position of the electron. We have to take into consideration the wave nature of electron and also the particle nature to describe the model of an atom. So taking these two factors into consideration, a new model of atom was proposed, which is called as quantum mechanical model of atom. So when you say quantum mechanics, it is a new branch of science which takes dual nature of matter into consideration. We have seen in the previous videos what is meant by dual nature of matter, which means matter can behave as both wave and also as particle. And taking this concept into consideration, a new branch of science was developed, and that was developed by Erwin Schrödinger, and that branch of science is called as quantum mechanics. So considering all this, Schrödinger came up with the new model of an atom, and he came up with a very famous fundamental equation of quantum mechanics, which is written here, E psi is equal to h cap psi. This equation incorporates both wave particle nature of matter as proposed by de Broglie. To solve this equation, you need a knowledge of higher mathematics, and this is quite complex, so you will not be going in detail into this equation. I'll just tell you what is in this equation and what does that represent for a system. Say for example an atom. This is the Schrödinger equation. Here this H is the Hamiltonian operator, and it is a mathematical operator, and Schrödinger gave a recipe, which means a method, to construct this operator from the expression for the total energy of the system. So E is the energy and the psi is the wave function. When this equation was solved, the solution of that equation gives you the value of E and psi. The psi, which we call as the wave function, is a mathematical function, and its value depends upon the coordinates of the electron in the atom, and it does not carry any physical meaning. Just like when you talk about sound and light, you can draw the sound wave and light wave, and it is represented as amplitude, but only the square of the amplitude gives you the intensity. The square of the amplitude has a significance. Same way here, psi has no significant physical significance, meaning any meaning, but psi square gives you the probability of finding the electron at that point. Just like how square of amplitude gives you the intensity, same way the square of psi gives you the probability of finding the electron at a point. So from the value of psi square at different points within an atom, it is possible to predict the region around the nucleus where the electron will most probably be found. So this psi square gives you the probability where you can find the electron at the maximum level. So when you use this psi to describe an electron in an atom, we say that the electron occupies that orbital which is described by that wave function. Since many wave functions are possible for one particular electron, there are many atomic orbitals in an atom. So based on this psi and psi square only, we talk about these atomic orbitals, and then we came up with quantum numbers. When Schrödinger equation is solved for hydrogen atom, the solution gives the possible energy levels the electron can occupy, and it can give you the corresponding wave functions of the electron associated with each energy level. These energy states, which are quantized, and the corresponding wave functions, which are characterized by three quantum numbers, they arise as a natural consequence in the solution of Schrödinger equation, which means when you solve the Schrödinger equation, you get all this quantum number value. So that numbers tells you about the position of the electron in an atom. And we have seen about these quantum numbers in the previous video, and I've told you three quantum numbers come as a solution when we solve Schrödinger equation, and we have included the fourth quantum number, which is spin quantum number, to describe the spin of the electron. As I told you already, as many wave functions are possible for an electron, there are many atomic orbitals in an atom. The energies of these orbitals of hydrogen depend only on the quantum number n, and the energies of the orbitals in multi-electron atoms depend on the quantum numbers n and l, which we will be seeing in detail now. So all you have to understand is there are two types of mechanics. One is classical mechanics, the other one is quantum mechanics. This classical mechanics is based on the Newton's law of motion, and this successfully explained the orbital motion of the macroscopic particles like planets. But this could not explain the microscopic particles like electrons' motion or orbit around the atom. For that purpose, we have quantum mechanics, and this is based on de Broglie's dual nature of matter. So here we talk about only the probability of finding the electron. As I just told you, the square of the wave function, which is psi, gives the probability density of the electron at that point. So these are the plots of orbital wave function psi. This is the variation of psi square, which is probability density as a function of distance of the electron from the nucleus. R is the distance of the electron from the nucleus. This is for 1s and 2s orbitals. Now look this variation of psi square as a function of R. Here the probability density is maximum at the nucleus when the distance is so here the probability is maximum. This is nearer to the nucleus. As you move, okay, the distance from the nucleus increases, of the electron increases. So near the nucleus it is maximum, and it decreases sharply as we move away from it, from the nucleus. Now look for the 2s orbital. Here you can note the probability density at first increases, and then it decreases sharply as we move away from it. Okay, so first it increases, okay, and then it drops to zero, and again it starts increasing. So after reaching a small maxima, it decreases again and approaches zero as the value of R increases. So this region where it goes to a zero, this is called as the nodal plane. Do you remember when we in the previous video discussed about the nodes in 1s and 2s? We said in 1s there are no nodes because here you don't have any zero point. But in the case of 2s, see, you have 1 0 point where the probability of finding the electron is zero. So we wrote in 2s we have one node. In the case of 3s we have two nodes. So we drew something like that, and we said this spherical area is called as node. So that is represented by this zero position. So the psi square gives you the probability of finding the electron around the nucleus. Here we are talking about 1s and 2s orbitals. Like this, there are large number of orbitals. So quantitatively, we distinguish these orbitals based on their size, shape and orientation using the quantum numbers. What are the quantum numbers that we have seen? Principal quantum number, azimuthal quantum number, magnetic quantum number and spin quantum number. So we have different shells and subshells in an atom. Now we are going to see how the electrons are filled in these shells and subshells following certain principles. We have seen for s orbital, we have different s orbitals, 1s, 2s, 3s, 4s, 5s and goes on. Same way for p orbital, it starts from 2p, 3p, 4p and it goes on. Same way for d orbital, we have 3d, 4d and 5d. And within the same subshell, we have different orientations. When we write 2px, we know the shape of p orbital is dumbbell, which means the probability of finding the electron is in the shape of dumbbell, and if it is maximum on the x axis, then we write it as 2px. If that probability is maximum on the p y axis, we write it as 2py. Same way for z axis, we write 2pz. So different subshells like this are present, and they have different orientations. Same way for d orbital, there are 5 different orientations. Now, when we have k shell, how many subshells are there? just one subshell is there. When you take L, you have two subshells, 2S and 2P. When you go to M shell, we have three subshells, 3S, 3P, 3D. And you have to note one thing, they have different energies, and we have seen how the energies increase. Now see, 1S has a lower energy than 2S, and 2S has a lower energy than 3S. But different subshells of the same main shell, see, this is the main shell, L shell, in that you have two different subshells. That two different subshells will have different energies. See, 2S has a lesser energy than 2P, but the orbitals within the same subshell all will have the same energy. Now all this 3 will have same energy, and all this 5 will have same energy. We call that as degenerate level, degenerate orbitals, which means they have the same energy. Now I'm talking about different energies of these orbitals. When you draw a diagram representing the arrangement of the orbitals in order of their increasing energies, then we call that diagram as energy level diagram. This is the order of the energies of different orbitals. This is for hydrogen atom, it is an exception. See, 1s, this is K shell. L shell, you have 2s, 2p, both are equal. In the third shell, you have 3s, 3p, 3d, all the three are equal. And the fourth shell, you have 4s, 4p, 4d, 4f. All are equal. But see, 1s is lower in energy than 2s and 2p, and 3s, 3p, 3d are higher in energy than 2s and 2p. So this is the order of the energies of the orbitals for hydrogen atom. But in the case of multi-electron atom, this is the order. 1s is lesser than 2s, and then lesser than 2p, 3s, 3p, and I've written it in the increasing order. See, after 3s, 3p, it's not 3d, it is 4s. So compared to 3d, 4s has got the lower energy. So we have a pattern to remember this and write this easily. So look here, you have 1s, 2s, 2p, 3s, 3p, 3d, write everything in a line, and then put an arrow like this. See, first comes 1s, and then 2s, 2p, after 2p, the arrow goes this way, so 3s, after 3s, come here again, 3p, and then 4s, and then 3d, 4p, 5s, 4D, 5P, 6S, 4F, 5D, 6F, 7S, 5F, 6D, 7P. This is the order. So while filling the orbitals in an atom with electrons, I told you certain rules are followed. One such rule is called as Aufbau principle. Aufbau in German meaning building up. So you're going to build up the atoms with electrons. So the rule is, in the ground state of the atoms, the orbitals are filled in order of their increasing energies. So this is the order of increasing energies, and the electron is filled accordingly. And remember one more thing, S orbital can have a maximum of 2 electrons, and P orbital can have a maximum of 6. I told you, P subshell can have a maximum of 6 electrons, because in P subshell there are 3 orbitals, and each orbital can accommodate 2 electrons. So 2px, 2PY, 2PZ, so each carrying 2 electrons, so totally 6 electrons. Same way, D subshell can have a maximum of 10 electrons, because D subshell can have 5 orbitals, and each orbital can accommodate 2 electrons. So remember that. And now you're going to fill the electrons in the increasing order only. This is what Aufbau principle says. For that you can follow a rule called N plus 1 rule. See, N plus L rule states that lower the value of N plus L for an orbital, the lower is its energy. Hence, orbitals are filled in order of increasing N plus L values. See, what is N? It's principal quantum number. What is L? It is azimuthal quantum number. So for an electron, if you take the principal quantum number and azimuthal quantum number and add it and compare it with the another electron's N plus L value, the lower N plus L value will be filled first. For example, see, for 2s, what is the N value? 2. For s, L is equal to 0. So when you add N plus L, 2 plus 0 is equal to 2. So N plus L value is 2. For 3p, N is equal to 3, L is equal to 1. For p, it is equal to 1. So 3 plus 1 is equal to 4. Now, which is the lower N plus L value? This one. So 2s is filled first, and then 3p is filled. So that is the N plus L rule. So if two orbitals have the same N plus L value, then the orbital with lower n value, okay, has the lower energy and hence it is filled first. Suppose if you add the values and you get the same n plus l value, then look for the n value. The one with the lower n value will be filled first. So this is what Aufbach's principle says. Next rule that we need to follow is Pauli's exclusion principle. According to this principle, no two electrons in an atom can have the same set of four quantum numbers. So far we have seen four different quantum numbers which are like the address of an electron in an atom. So according to Pauli's exclusion principle, no two electrons in an atom can have the same set of four quantum numbers, which means at least one of the quantum numbers will be different for the two electrons. The other way to state Pauli's exclusion principle is an orbital can have a maximum of two electrons and these must have opposite spins. We have seen already in each orbital there can be a maximum of two electrons. So in an orbital, if the three quantum numbers like principal quantum number, azimuthal quantum number and magnetic quantum number, if all the three are same, at least what will be different? The spin of the two electrons will be different. So obviously the electrons will have different spin quantum number, which means no two electrons can have same set of four quantum numbers. Say for example, if you take 3s orbital, so in each orbital there can be only two electrons. So in 3s orbital there are two electrons. For 3s orbital, what is the n value? What is the principal quantum number? It is equal to 3. And for 3s, what is the l value? It is s. For s, l is equal to 0. So l value is equal to 0. And for each l value, you have m value from plus l to minus l. So here, since l is 0, m is also equal to 0. So there are two electrons. For both the electrons, n is equal to 3, l is equal to 0 and m is equal to 0. Now what will be the s value? For one electron it will be plus half, for the other electron it will be minus half. I told you already, for plus half it will be represented by an upward arrow, or you can write like this. And for anti-clockwise spin, we write a downward arrow. So see, this is an orbital. Inside an orbital, there are two electrons and it should be represented this way. One with the clockwise spin, the other electron with the anti-clockwise spin. Or they can be represented like this. Both are same, but here the first is clockwise, the next one is anti-clockwise. Here first electron is anti-clockwise, the second electron is clockwise. So either ways you can represent. If that 3s orbital is having only one electron, it can be represented either with the upward arrow or like this, this or this. So all these representations are correct, but it should not be represented like this, both with the upward arrow, both with the downward arrow. So when we say a 3s orbital can have a maximum of two electrons, it doesn't mean it should always have two electrons. It is filled accordingly to the number of electrons present in a given atom. So if it is ending with 3s1, then it is also possible, but maximum it can have two electrons, which means 3s can be present without an electron or with one electron or with two electrons, not more than that. So this is what Pauli's exclusion principle says. No two electrons in an atom can have the same set of four quantum numbers. The next rule is Hund's rule of maximum multiplicity. This is for a degenerate orbitals. I told you when you take a p subshell, it will be oriented in three different directions. What are they? Px, Py, Pz. And each orbital will be having the same energy as the other, which means Px, Py and Pz have the same energy. Same way for D subshell, Dxy, Dyz, Dzx, Dz square, Dx square, Y square, all of them have the same energy. So we call them as degenerate orbitals. In the case of S, we just have one orientation. So this Hund's rule is not needed there. But look here. The Hund's rule states that the pairing of electrons in the orbitals belonging to the same subshell, does not take place until each orbital belonging to that subshell has got one electron each. That is, it is singly occupied. See, how many electrons can be present in p orbital? The maximum there can be 6 electrons, because there are 3 orbitals. Each orbital can accommodate 2 electrons. So 2 plus 2 plus 2 will be equal to 6. Now, according to Hund's rule, unless and until all these orbitals are singly occupied by electrons, pairing will not occur. Now look here, for p3, I'm supposed to write 1, 2, 3, all the orbitals are singly occupied, and then only if it is 4p4, then only the pairing occurs here. But writing like this is not right. See, 1, 2, 3, this orbital is empty, this is not right. So all the orbitals should have one electron each, and then only pairing should take place. This is applicable for degenerate orbitals. Now coming to d4, for example, if you have a configuration d4, which means you have 4 electrons in the d subshell, and there are 5 orbitals in d subshell, you have 1 2 3 4. This is the right way of writing the electrons in the orbitals. This is not the right way. See, 1 2 3 4, all these 3 are empty. According to Hund's rule, all this should be having single electron, then only you have to pair from this orbital. So the pairing of electrons in the orbitals belonging to the same subshell does not take place until each orbital belonging to that subshell has got one electron each. So this is Hund's rule of maximum multiplicity. So we have seen 3 rules: Arfpass principle, Pauli's exclusion principle, and Hund's rule of maximum multiplicity. We have to follow all these rules while we write the electronic configuration of an atom, which we will be seeing in the next video. Now we will see an example to find out the quantum numbers for an electron in an atom. Now the question is, an electron is in a 4f orbital. What possible values for the quantum numbers n, l, m and s can have? So the given electron is present in 4f orbital. So when you write 4f, this 4 represents the principal quantum number. So what is the n value? N is equal to 4. And when you write f, what is the l value for f? It is 3. Remember, L is equal to 0 for S subshell, L is equal to 1 for P subshell, L is equal to 2 for B subshell, and L is equal to 3 for F. So now we have L is equal to 3 because this is F subshell. And we know for L value, M can have plus L to minus L through 0. So this is 3. So what are the possible M values? Minus 3, minus 2, minus 1, 0, plus 1 and plus 2. So F subshell has how many orientations? 7 orientations. So for each value of M, how many S values are possible? 2 S values, because in an orbital, the 2 electrons can have 2 different spin, clockwise or anti-clockwise. So S is equal to plus half or minus half. There are 2 values possible. So to answer that question, how many, what are the possible values of N, L, M and S for 4F orbital? So N will be equal to 4, L equal to 3, and M can have all these values, and S can have these 2 values, plus half and minus half. So just from this designation 4F, we have predicted where the electron would be, in which shell, in which subshell, and what would be its spin. So as I said already, these quantum numbers are like an address to the electrons in an atom. So in the next video, we will be seeing how to write the electronic configuration. Thank you.